Thank you very much for the introduction, Harold. I'm glad to be invited to share with you some ideas of Milton Santos, especially because I don't think he's such a well-known scholar, philosopher, as he should be worldwide. I think he's much more recognized abroad than in Brazil itself. Obviously, in the late years, he has been recognized. He's not just a geographer, but I'd say he's an intellectual, a Brazilian intellectual. That's very important to help us to think about ourselves, not just Brazilians, but the world as a mankind. I'm glad to be here. Thank you. I hope to talk to artists. So I'm trying to approach his ideas from a point of view that would be interacting with the theme that you selected to talk about. From what I understand, has to do with racism and migration and prejudice and all these phenomena that we are dealing with in our contemporary world. So to start with, I must say that it was really hard to try to make a short talk on Milton Santos, because his production is very, very wide, and it goes from matters towards the worries with geography itself to worries of the environment as a whole, as a production system that we live in. So he's very critical of capitalism, as you will get to get closer to his ideas, but still, I will try to make it in quarter of an hour, 20 minutes at most, brief talk on that. So I will share my screen if you allow me. Let's see if it will work. I hope so. Okay. Just please tell me when you will see it on your screen. Okay. I will just change here, exhibition. Can you see it already?
Yes.
Yeah? Is it full screen?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So let's start. Who is Milton Santos? I'd say Milton Santos was a Brazilian intellectual born in Bahia, who built his academic path outside Brazil. And that's very curious, because he built it outside his own country. As an academic, he interacted with a large network of international researchers, got to visit and live in several countries. He was banned from Brazil when the dictatorship in 1964 started, and he stayed abroad until the end of the 70s. So most of his mature career, he developed out abroad. So he was a lecturer in United States, Canada, France. He had a very important career in France at several universities, including Sorbonne, just to mention one, in United States, MIT, to mention another important one. He has taken jobs in Africa, even in South America, like Venezuela, he developed some work. So he was very well known abroad before being well known in Brazil. That's very important, very curious, because that is it's how we see him, someone that built himself outside his own country and then comes in the country. So it has a lot to do with this off-axis perspective that I mentioned as a title in this talk. So let's see, in this way, I think he had the possibility of thinking about Brazil from a certain distance, what clears our minds sometimes, because he was based on a bibliography of that was produced outside the national context, which brought him an original perspective and led to the creation of new theories to explain very well-known phenomena, not just Brazilian phenomena, but worldwide phenomena. Has a lot to do with, for instance, the idea of how mankind is getting even more individualist. So he has a few phrases that I started presenting them to you that are very important to get to know his train of thought. So he would say, the strength of alienation comes from the fragility of individuals when they can only identify what separates them and not what unites them. And that's very important because as we face the difference, we face it with a certain prejudice because we don't get related immediately to it. So rationally, we put it apart, put these people apart, and we start seeing those that are different as a threat. So that's the idea he builds to explain how this growth of racism, growth of prejudice, growth of conflicts can arrive. So the fundamental idea that is behind all his thought and his production, in my interpretation, is that inequality is the fundamental condition that drives society towards racism, intolerance, and prejudice. Because when people are migrating and finding themselves other places to live, they don't do that as a first choice. Where are most people living? We should ask ourselves. When we see this picture by NASA, we can identify, I hope you can see my mouse, we can identify all these bright spots. The bright spots are surely where we find cities, where we find infrastructure installed, where we have lights to enlight the night. To have the creation of the men to be able to set themselves in comfortable positions, in comfortable places. So transforming the nature into something that is more convenient for their own use. So they transform the natural environment. And that's a very important idea for Milton Santos. So when we see all these bright spots around the world, we can surely identify those are places where we find cities, and we find cities with infrastructure. So should we just believe where we see the bright spots, everybody's living at the bright spots, and then we discover, no, that's not the idea. You know, in the 80s, back when I was studying in Europe, I remember we used to talk a lot about the conflict between North and South. And because everybody in the northern part of the Earth would say, okay, the South, I mean, the equator is around here, the South part of the Earth is not as well developed, referring mostly to Africa and South America, as we from the North. So the perspective of the talk of the conflicts and of the differences that we would find in the world would be based on the difference of infrastructure installed, development strategies, and always looking top down to those that were, let's say, out of the system, okay? So that's why we start changing a little bit when we see things differently. When we look at this other map, that's also by NASA, we can't really doubt it's a true information because it shows the darker, it shows where people are living. So if we compare both maps, we see there are loads of cities here we can identify, and there are loads of people. But when we see this map compared to this one, we see this is an empty place. We would first of all think, oh, okay, there are no people here. There's a desert somewhere in Africa that probably covers the whole country. But that's not true because we have people living here, and we have people living here without infrastructure. We have people living here in a very difficult condition, and we have people here wanting to leave their own places, their own territory, to migrate to better opportunities. So we have to understand which dynamics involve all this migration process. Now, the lack of opportunities in certain parts of the world, even if we think worldwide and we focus on Africa as a continent that is surely a place that exports its population to other states, especially Europe, we can also think inside of a country. And being a Brazilian, I feel comfortable to talk about Brazil. So if we see there are many people living in the northeast of Brazil and not as many light and bright places around here as we have people. Okay, so when we think how are people living, we must consider inequality as a fundamental structural characteristic. And that means that we have differences. We have differences, but we have inequality that's much worse than differences. Differences can be very, very interesting. Diversity is well received for a society. When diversity is intrinsic or is incorporated to the society, we have more creativity, we have more open-minded, we have more diversity on looking up on the other, on the different, not as a some prejudice, but as a quality that can bring other views. So when we look at this map and we compare to the previous ones, we see the darker it gets, the higher is the inequality index called Gini. That's an index that creates a measurement in between the difference of the wealth in between the most rich and the poorest. So we see there is a very difficult situation down south in Africa, and we see the northern countries like Scandinavian. We have Norway, Sweden, Finland here, and some Eastern countries that are a kind of quite equilibrated, let's say. Not we don't find all this inequality, and we will start finding more inequality in places that are known to be rich countries, such as United States. Yeah, so this will vary. And it will increase towards very, very surprising places because of the engagement of the capitalist system in a more greedy way towards the territory. So that's how we have to think about. And that's how Milton Santos would be thinking about. So another data that I find very interesting to think about migration. You can say, oh, but what is that to do with what we're talking about? But it has a lot to do. Where are landmines contaminating the world? So where are bombs still active? Because there were conflicts on Earth. So if you look at Africa, you can see how many mines you can still find if you're just walking around. So many, many, many African young people lose their legs, for instance, because they step on mines. All these areas were object to conflict for centuries. Okay, we still have some very difficult places around Europe as well. The previous territory of Yugoslavia, for instance, and I think we have an artist from Yugoslavia as well. So it's very important to look at this map and then understand another reason for people to leave their own places, to leave their own countries. Okay, so when we see where or how are people moving around the world, where are they going to? We see there are many, many people leaving Africa and the Middle East towards places, certainly Europe is a destination, looking for better opportunities of living. So it's despairing. If you don't have any infrastructure, if you're in a field of war, even if the war has cooled down, the wars are still present in the territory. We have many flux of population or from South America towards North America. Yeah, that's how we see in the news. We can see all the conflicts that are happening. So this map is also produced by the United Nations. So this is information that you can check on if you cannot believe the flux. So what Milton Santos would say, formally, the great nations sent their armies to conquer territories, and the name of this was colonization. Today, the great nations send their multinationals to conquer markets, and the name of this is globalization. So if the problem was to exploit nations through colonialism, now it's to exploit people and nations through imposed consumerism. That's how I interpret it. So greed is going to extinguish mankind if we don't stop consuming what we don't need, okay? So this is very important notion to deal with Milton Santos' writings, yeah? I brought this map. It's not too beautiful. I don't like the graphics of it, but I think it's very, very clear the idea that is expressed here. So how land and resources have been distributed? Okay, in between 1885 and 1914, just before the First World War, there was this agreement signed in Berlin that divided the territory of Africa as it was some kind of good that we could share in between those that were already colonial empires. So we see how brutal, I'd say, is the way Africa is divided. So we have the British, we have the French, the German, the Portuguese, Italian, Belgian, Spanish, and just one single independent country over here and another one over here. But still, Liberia is also another case. I won't talk about it right now. But we see this as some kind of mercantilization of something that is not possible to commercialize. That's land, that's territory of people that were living there. We're not talking about an empty space that had to be occupied. And that's a very important notion as well. So in between 1914 and 1918, during the First World War, we still had this situation. So most of this area that we see in this darkish green belong to France. So why are so many Black people from Africa arriving in France? Can anyone explain it? Just look at this map. Why are so many people pressuring Italy? Yeah. Why so many people trying to get into Britain when they come all from Africa? Because they are linked to the original colonial references they had. Most countries in Africa will speak English or French besides their native language, that most of them are being forgotten by the younger population. So it's really cruel to see this map and think they shared Africa as a cake. Yeah. I bring the example now to South America. How land and resources have been distributed here in South America? For the curiosity, I think most of you will have the time to see it more carefully. But we have here South America, the Central America, and this is the part of the territory of the United States these days. But it's still Mexico, just so you know, would go up north, and what's New Mexico in the States it was part of Mexico. So then there comes this government in the States that says, okay, Mexico has nothing to do with the United States. We must build a wall and we cannot have all this immigration coming into our territory when the territory was original from Mexico, even if Mexico was already a colony of the Spanish Empire. So all this belongings, all this property of land is some very difficult matter to discuss. How did they divide the Spanish and Portuguese Empire, divided South America? They draw a line, literally geometrical line, calculated from certain islands out here, that they imagined a line and said, okay, from here onwards will be unknown land and it will belong to the Spanish Empire. From the line towards the coast, it will belong to the Portuguese. So this was a first line drawn, Tratado de Tordesillas in Portuguese. Tordesillas Treaty, if you would translate. You probably get some more information on that. I won't be too long on this. But this is very important for Milton Santos as well, because how do they treat the territory? They draw lines. Then when it was already decided how we will share South America in between Spanish and Portuguese, the Portuguese draw horizontal lines, aleatory lines, to divide all this territory that would belong to the crown, the Portuguese crown. So it was divided and shared to whom? To the noble families that would be invited or be even imposed from the crown to colonize the territory, the new land. But I mean, wasn't there anybody around here? Yes, obviously there were. There were the native people living here, not just in this part of Brazil, but in whole America. So you probably, most of you know about all the killing of the native groups that were living all along the Andes, and all this land was occupied. It's something that you must have the notion. It's an invasion. It's not a discovery. All this process of colonialism was mostly a process of invasion and appropriation of the land of other people. Yeah, so it was based on conflict. It was based on slavery. But the locals here in South America, especially the Tupi-Guarani group of Indians, they were not very easy to deal with in terms of enforced work. So there was this process of importing workforce from Africa. Importing is like they would treat, because they would treat people as goods. So people were brought from Africa as slaves, and they were brought to Brazil to work in farms, in planting sugarcane first, then coffee. But this was very intensive. This picture, I really love this picture. It shows when the Crown Prince Isabel signed a document that would liberate all the slaves from the obligation of slavery, and that was in 1888. And this picture shows the amount of people on the streets just celebrating the chance of being free. But free to what? They were free to work for nothing. They were free to have nowhere to live. They were free to be let out of the slavery process of working. But what would they do? Which land would they conquer? they wouldn't conquer land, they wouldn't be given land, they wouldn't have a place to be. So how land would be distributed, how it is distributed these days? Do we have the right of occupying the territory or any land that's disoccupied or apparently not occupied? So all these people were let out in the streets and they had no place to live. So you can imagine the pressure over all the cities that were already being formed in Brazil, because at the end of the 19th century, we didn't have really big cities. Rio de Janeiro was the capital. Remembering, for those who don't know our history well, I mean, Brasilia was built in the 60s, in 1960s. So up to then, Rio de Janeiro was the capital. And before that, it had been Salvador in Bahia. This picture shows the amount of people down here and the princes up here. This taken top down is the basis of the conduction of the political actions of most states, not just Brazil, let's say. And then we come up to this picture. Wow, what is this? How diversity is seen by society. If we think Brazil was colonized by Portuguese, we had the native Indian population, we had all these black people being brought as slaves from Africa. Our population is certainly very mixed, very mixed. But still, if you look at this picture, if any of you came up to Brazil in Carnival, now probably I invite you to go to Recife. Now, I think most of those that are listening to me would agree, but this picture is from Bahia, and I brought it from Bahia because not just Milton Santos is from Bahia, but because it's very well known worldwide as well. And if you look carefully to the picture, you will see there's a line here, and there's a line here, and you see these guys with orange shirts blocking all these people that are gathered on this side and all these people that are gathered on this side, and there is a less dense space around here. So this shows how our society is hypocrite. We see everybody as an equal. We create the idea of a nation that observes diversity without prejudice. We have this image set up, but that's not true. So even in Carnival, we still have different places for those who belong to the upper society, distant from everybody else, all the rest of the people of the country. So all these people are mixed. Everybody has some kind of blood mixed with some other kind of origin. No one is clearly identified with one single origin. So we still have the places that are up here, and we still have this down situation towards the inevitable differences, but not just differences in between people, but inequality between them. We can see inequality in this picture. But is diversity always celebrated? Because even if you say, oh, there is this inequality, but everybody's partying, Carnival is such an experience that gathers people. No? We can see the representation here of these giant puppets that show how our population is from every single color. We have black, we have blondes, we have people that are in between. We have a mixture of features in Brazil that anybody in the school could be a Brazilian. You would find somewhere where the mixture would produce a type, a physical appearance as you have. So anybody can be Brazilian if you just look at the person. So that's very different in Europe. We don't see this diversity of types as much as we see in Brazil. But this is changing, and it's changing for the last decades. And still there is a lot of resistance in between nations inside the society, the European society resists a lot towards the idea of changing their appearance as a group, as a society. So if you're Scandinavian, and you must be blonde with blue eyes or light eyes anyway, and it's a fact that they don't have very many people with green eyes, but they have a lot of people with blue eyes. Anyway, but this is changing from the 80s onwards. I mean, the population from Middle East, from Africa, is growingly going towards Europe, and they're mixing and they're becoming Europeans, and their descendants are surely Europeans. They are from other colors, but they are Europeans. So it's not always that this diversity is welcome and celebrated, not even in Brazil, even if it shows, it seems like that. Okay. So when does diversity lead to exclusion? And that's an important idea for Milton Santos as well. When you have poverty, it's not just inequality, but poverty. When we look at this map of Brazil, I hope most of you understand that here we have the Atlantic Ocean from the previous maps. And from here onwards, we have the rest of South America. I don't like maps that are floating, but I'm sorry, I got this at this very good source, it's the Atlas. Exclusão Social no Brasil. That's a very good work to consult. Anyway, so we have the red as the poorest and the green as the less poor. And I say less poor because we have many good and developed cities around this area of the country. That's the Southeast. And here we have the West of the country. That's not so populated as the Southeast. But even if people don't have large amount of capital accumulated, they live well. So when we consider poverty, we have to consider the means of survival in Brazil for this mapping. So most of the areas in the Northeast and in the north of the country have a very bad situation. So there is a lack of opportunities, there is a lack of resources to produce and to engage the population in this production. And that's vital to understand because as I showed the world map showing how African people go towards Europe. Here in Brazil, we could say, the Northeast exports its population to the South and Southeast because there are no conditions of living in a comfortable way, in a modern comfortable way for most people here. Okay. Well, so it's important to retain that Brazil, being a peripheral country, what it means, it's not in the center of the decision-making. It's always subordinated to the decision-making that's made internationally by those who command the world. So the orders are located outside its territorial competence and competence and leave a small margin for the choice of paths capable of attributing from within a destiny to the national territory itself. Let's try to explain this. These are Milton Santos words, but I mean, all the orders, I mean, everything, the command comes from outside and the decisions are taken outside the country. The territory itself doesn't command the choices. The reality doesn't matter so much for those who have interests that go beyond the interests of the territory itself. So if I have to make choices as part of the people of the country, I don't have a channel to make these choices, regular time channel to change things, to see from our own perspective with all the means to decision making. So this is a very important idea because how could we invert the situation? And that's what Milton Santos explore. How can this change? And he has hope this is changing. He believes in his last words that this is changing. So how is the dynamics between center and periphery? I brought now a map of the city of São Paulo. This is one of the five largest cities in the world. And that's the capital of the state of São Paulo. That's the richest city in Brazil. And what is it showing? I mean, IDH is Development Human Index. That's the same thing that UN works with. So this is a way of seeing that the center of São Paulo and this expanded center is the best place to live. Okay, it's all full of infrastructure. If anyone from any world where would come to São Paulo and live around here, would it be possible to feel just as comfortable as in any other big city in the world, north or south of the equator. So you have the best provided services. You have everything you can imagine you need. You have a beautiful city around this yellow bit here. And then you have this other arch that covers an interface with the rest of the town that's also very, very pleasant to live. And then it starts to get rough. I mean, as you go towards the periphery, the outskirts, as one would say for cities, you would see the outskirts as very, very unpleasant places to be light. But I mean, all this conflict that results from poverty, from inequality, from social exclusion, you can see around here. So they created this other index. And again, I show it in Portuguese because I really think this work is worth knowing. Juvenile vulnerability. I hope to explain it to you, but I mean, it's the risk the youth have in living in these areas. So youth is at risk when you talk about the outskirts. There is the danger. There is the danger. That's the dangerous place to be young, black, and without any money. There is a data that I don't have it right now, but I mean, people that are black and young, they die much more than any other one, and they die in the outskirts because they are killed because they don't have social security, they don't have the state present. The state doesn't fulfill the needs of people in the outskirts. And then we have this conclusion map that shows the exclusion map or inclusion, social inclusion. So obviously this is the social included ones. And as you go towards the outskirts, you're less included. So you are excluded. And these are elements, fundamental elements to understand all this thought Milton Santos had about the territory and how the inversion of the logic will be happening. Because when we look at the income, this is just data on the income, because the previous map would mix income and education and other resources. Here we have just income, and we just confirm that those who have better income live close to the center, okay? And those who have less income are going further and further away from the good, privileged city. Yeah, they live in the outskirts, or even as the process has been shown, outside the whole city and in the region of São Paulo. So the metropolitan region in the past decades grows much more than the city itself in terms of population, because people don't have means, not even to live in the outskirts of the city of São Paulo. So they live in other municipalities that are part of this metropolitan region. So this process of spreading around this urban areas and getting the poor out of view, it's almost that, it's a process that we can think of places such as France, for instance. How many housing projects are built that are just occupied for immigrants outside Paris or any big city in France, just to mention France, because they have a very good policy of housing, building and access, if compared to Brazil, obviously, not if you compare to Holland or Switzerland, yeah. But still, we think of these people and we can see how they are placed outside the best part of the territory. Okay, so how does Milton Santos see the poor? Because that's the basic idea. The poor have the strength. That's his interpretation of the time now. So the poor are wise because they know the experience of scarcity. So when they don't have anything, they have to be creative. They have to face life as a challenge of survival. So in the banal space, as he calls, and I translate to ordinary, but I mean, as the word exists in English, I decided to maintain it, because ordinary is the ordinary life. Yeah, it's the daily life, it's the real life. A large part of the population does not follow the laws and the norms and the rules, I'd say, as they do not submit themselves to the state, which does not welcome them as well. And they are also not tied to the formal market economy. So how do these people survive? I mean, they are warriors, I'd say. They are warriors because of their condition of living. They are formed to be warriors. If you don't face the challenge and you don't, you're not able to survive, you would be dead. Okay, so how is this dynamic between center and periphery again? Just to have this idea, how this tension works. I mean, we have some pictures here. They are immigrants in confrontation with the police. These scenes are very recent. They are scenes of South Americans trying to enter the United States. I think a few of you might have seen the news in the past weeks about this. We have another scene here that's not a conflict, but it's surely impressive. That's MST Brazil. That's a movement of landless people. So landless popular movements are growing as well. I believe not just in Brazil, but this one in Brazil is very well known. And it fights for the right of having access to land. What does it mean? It means it fights for the right of living. It fights for its existence. How can you have means of living if you don't have the land? Yeah, it's like if you don't have the air, if you don't have the water. So the natural resources are fundamental to understand. The access to natural resources is fundamental to understand the possibility of living in this earth, okay? So again, I repeat, the poor are wise because they know the experience of scarcity. In principle, they adopt actions that subvert the current order imposed from top down and build the possibility of defining actions from bottom up, leading to processes that are on the way to becoming revolutionary. And that's what Milton Santos says about the strength and the force of this movement that comes from the periphery towards the center. It's a pressure for the need of survival. So when we, I'm close to the end now, when we go and see how this materializes in the space, so this is another category, very, very important for Milton Santos, the space, the urban space, is where it materializes the relationship between people and land. and we look at the picture that we're looking at from Johnny Miller, it's a fabulous photographer that he inspired himself from this very famous Brazilian picture taken from the contrast in between a very rich building with swimming pools, one by per pavement, looking out to this favela, to this shanty town. So he now is a very well-known photographer who registers this inequality built in cities. So this is a scene from India, in Mumbai. Mumbai, as you may know, is one of the most important cities in India, in the world, let's say. And we have this settlement, very dense and precarious, divided by a wall here, where we have the rich and well-designed settlement for richer, let's say, for the richer, yeah? So this is not a mock image. This is a real image taken with a drone, yeah? So it's important to retain that the bright spots, those that we saw in the beginning of this speech, concentrate regions endowed with infrastructure inseparable as to their productive use, where hegemonic actions are taken to integrate broader economic levels, not local ones. So all those lightened up places in the world are these days very much connected, but they are commanded by hegemonic actions and decisions taken by the center. So it's not just in the scale of this internal settlement in the city that we see inequality. We see inequality in the relationship of various scales. So natural resources are seen as sources of wealth instead of vital elements to mankind on Earth. And that has been since colonization. That's what Milton Santos says. If that was how the colonialism led the process of appropriating themselves, the central nations, the imperialistic nations would take the world's, the land of the world for their own benefit. Now we see the enterprises profiting from not just natural resources, but workforce all over the world. Yeah. Continuing, this is another place. This is Kia Sands. I'm sorry, it's misspelled. But still, we see the contrast between the favela and the nice rich settlements with the houses and their swimming pools, their green gardens. And here we don't have asphalt. For instance, we don't have any green spot. And that's really significant. We have a road here that divides the two settlements, and we don't have any green. So inequality and diversity are part of the dynamics between center and periphery that happens in different scales, as I was saying, within the urban space, within a country, within a continent, within the world. Yeah. So this is Lake Michel, Cape Town. So some are living by the lake with all the goods the territory can offer. And some don't even have how to access their home with dignity, with the least they need to survive. So for Milton Santos, there are only two social classes, and this is strong, I think. Those who do not eat and those who do not sleep for the fear of the revolution of those who do not eat. These dynamics characterize the popular period of history. And saying that, I finish my speech and I hope I have introduced you to some of the large wild and very interesting thoughts that Milton Santos left us to think about our life and humanity and this world. I thank you for the opportunity, and here I finish my speech. Thank you.